to admit it's getting better. It's a little better all the time.
You're getting better all the time. Now back to Ann Beal on 1160 AM KBDT.
Counting the cars on the New Jersey Turnpike, they've all come to look for a man.
Colonel Ray Ivey, are you there?
I am here.
All right.
We sure want to hear your story all about what the 4th of July means to you.
Let me start with an event of my first day as a pilot in a helicopter in Vietnam, if I could.
Yes.
Yes.
And that event takes place where I am 22 years old, flying in a flight into a hot LZ, bringing, just like you see in the movies, we were soldiers once. Mm-hmm. And as we bring those soldiers in there and drop them off, we were exchanging soldiers. And we had soldiers we were picking up out of there with dirty uniforms that had been in there in 30 or 45 days in the jungles fighting. And we're putting in guys with fresh uniforms. And as we fly in there, we pick these guys up and getting them out of there. They're dead and wounded, coming out of there at that time and putting in fresh soldiers. As we take off and come back around with our next load of fresh soldiers, I look back between my seats, and there lays a guy with a brand-new fresh uniform with a bullet through his head. And I started crying. 22 years old, and the guy that I'm flying is an airlift commander talking with the artillery, the infantry, the flight itself, and I see this guy as they drop him on the unit and on the aircraft that is in a new uniform. We had just dropped him off 15 minutes ago, and I started crying, and he sees that, and he yells at me, "Do I have to fly this aircraft too?" Because he's so busy that he needs me to do that. And I said, "No, sir, I have to concentrate on this flight and what my job is." And he said, "Exactly." And that's where you learn to compartmentalize and be callous about what you see. But you see guys running at your aircraft, and they get shot coming to your aircraft, and they grab that body and throw that body on the aircraft. And this guy here, he's only been in the fight for 15 minutes maybe, and he's dead. And I see that, and I say, he only is here because somebody in the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. has ordered us into this fight. Most of us are there just for that reason. Mm-hmm. They make the decisions. We don't. And we flew on out of there. And the day is over, and I go back to a bed that night in a compound. And in that moment, you realize that this is the way you're going to live for the next year. You don't get to do it for a day and it's over, or 2 or 3 days and it's over. It's going to be this way for 365 days. Mm-hmm. This is the way you're going to live. And then that night, they mortar and rocket a compound. And in that right there, there's mortars bursting all around us, and we're taking cover, going into bunkers. And a mortar will blast and blow a hole in the ground, maybe 6 or 10, 12 inches down in the ground. But the rocket comes in there, and it blows a hole in the ground that you can walk into and you're shoulder deep in the hole in the ground. Mm. If it hits your bunker, it's going to take the bunker out.
Yeah.
And all of this blasting and stuff like this. But you can tell as they change these positions on these bombs, rockets and mortars, they move them away from you because they're adjusting, trying to hit the whole compound. Mm-hmm. And as they do, you'll come out of your bunker and you'll look over there across the bunker and across the compound, and there stands our flag in the darkness, waving in the breeze. And you can see it. We have lights on them in the dark. And you see that. And as you're looking at it, my mind flashes back to exactly what Francis Scott Key wrote in the Star Spangled Banner, our national anthem. And I'm experiencing exactly what he saw that night. And that night, he is standing on a boat, a British boat, I might add, for people that are familiar with history. He has gone out there as a lawyer to negotiate the settlement of exchange of prisoners. And in that night, he is told that he wins. He gets the agreement to release those prisoners of Americans that are down below the decks. He gets that agreement. But they tell him that night that they are going to get bombard Fort Henry to the point that they're going to try to take down that flag. Either we're going to lower that flag and capitulate to the British that night, or they're going to get bombarded so much that the fort is going to be overtaken by that right there. And the flag, that's the flag in the Star Spangled Banner. They say, "Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light, so proudly we hail the twilight's last gleaming." They saw that flag during the day before that bombardment starts. That's one of the questions that's asked. And then in the last verse it ends, "Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave over the land of the..." That's what they were doing in the morning time, is to see if that flag was still standing, because they intended to turn that bombardment until the fact that there wasn't a flag standing over Fort McHenry. Mm-hmm. And yet it was that morning. And people died that night by raising that flag back up if it ever started to fail. And if people were killed holding it up right that night, other people would take their place and give their lives to keep the flag still flying. That's the 4th of July, and that's what soldiers did in Vietnam where I was. And that's what soldiers did in Desert Storm. And that's what soldiers have been doing throughout our history. That is the 4th of July. And that's what the 4th of July means to me. And I am one of those 7% that have served in military uniform. And that's what you say when you walk up to me and you say, "Thank you for your service." Or for me that didn't get a thank you when I got home from Vietnam, but do that. And when I came home from Desert Storm, that's what I saw as I walked into Philadelphia Airport, and bands were playing and kids were waving the flag and people were reaching out trying to high-five me or touch my hands or this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I see that's the welcome home that I didn't get in Vietnam, but I did get coming home from Desert Storm. That's what a veteran that you see from time to time, that's what we ought to be celebrating when we celebrate the 4th of July. It's not picnics, which I don't object to. And when you see a fireworks display on the 4th of July, that's what you're celebrating when our country in 1776 got its independence from the British. And we've been standing as a country, standing for the flag, holding the flag up since then. That's what 4th of July means to me.
Mm. I was a gymnast, and we'd have competitions with other countries, and when they would put up the United States of America flag, I was so proud because that was my country. The flag meant my country. That meant, okay, the Americans won a medal. You know, there were things about it. We'd always cry when they'd play it because it meant we're doing this for our country. And it's nothing like what you did, but when you're looking at that flag in the midst of all the craziness.
It means a country that stands out above all countries in the world. We have never taken over another country and held it. We have liberated France, but we didn't hold it. We've liberated other countries, but we've never held it. We liberated Iraq. But we've pulled back from it. We have given to other countries again and again and again over time. We are a country that has survived. Nobody from our country is going to other countries. We are a country that people want to come to us. Immigrants want to come to us. But we don't have other countries where people are going to them in floods like you have coming to here. That's the country we ought to be proud of. And other countries know it. We are a country that people seek to be a part of, But I would tell the immigrants that are coming here, don't come here to try to change us like the country you came to.
Yeah,
be the country that you came to be a part of.
Yes, because they left that country. They didn't want to be there anymore.
Yeah, they wanted to be here.
It just sounds like by you seeing the flag lit up, it saved your life in a lot of ways.
Yes, yes. All the time is, it's who are we here for? But I always also tell people that patriotic heroism on the battlefield, I also put it in perspective. We don't die for our country, truly. We die for the man next to us. We give our lives to protect the ones around us immediately.
Right.
We're in our country. But when you get on a battlefield and you're trying, just like you're trying to save your kid's life, you will throw yourself in front of a car or a bullet to save your child.
Right.
And it happens that way. And you said it earlier in the broadcast, is that there are no atheists on the battle table. When it comes down to your life and you expecting that you would be killed in the next few minutes or this day, and I felt that many times in Vietnam, which I didn't understand how I could live through the next day when you realize that every fifth round coming through this air in a hot LZ is every fifth round is a tracer, and you can see the tracers coming through there hot and glowing through an LZ. You realize there's four other ones that are coming through there that you can't even see, and you can feel the aircraft being shot up and shot. People that are being put on your aircraft, even your crew gets shot up, and you're sitting there not being shot up. There's a guilt about that. Mm. And I would tell people throughout my tour in Vietnam, since I had a wife and a 15-month-old child that I left, that I would leave any minute that you gave me a chance to jump on an aircraft and get out of there. But when you walk out of Vietnam on that last day, I turn and look back at the guys I was leaving, and tears start running down my cheeks because of the camaraderie you build among them.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And you come back to talk about that with other people, and you quit talking because people can't grasp this unless you've ever experienced it. You can only talk to another veteran because nobody can actually grasp that, and I don't expect them to. I mean, I used to think I could tell them about it and they would understand.
Right.
But you can't grasp it from a movie, and you can't grasp it from them, because until you are put in that situation. Now, a policeman, a fireman, the law enforcement people that risk their lives every day, and get in situations where they think that maybe this guy has got me pinned down and may be able to kill me, I'll give that to them. They recognize those times.
Right.
And Ray, it occurs to me that when you were out there doing that, defending, fighting to save the lives of your comrades around you, all of that you went through, when you were fighting for America and Americans, you weren't fighting for a country that planned to be a dictatorship, tyrannical, overrunning other countries and that kind of thing. What you fought for was freedom and liberty and opportunity. And, you know, that's the thing that makes America different, it seems to me.
I know that. It's got to be really, really hard for you when people kneel, when the flag's up. They just don't understand what they're doing. And it just breaks your heart, doesn't it?
In my mind, part of it is a short-sighted view of some sort of agenda they have. And they're using their liberty in a wrong way. Right now, we have people in this country that are Marxists, they're socialists, and they're jihadists. And under immigration, and they will try to take over this country.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, we'll
there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land.